Well, good morning, everyone. Can I have a good big good morning? Nice work.
For those of you who don't know me, I'm Alan. Hi. Welcome to everyone online as well. Good to see you all. And isn't it good to be here today? So there's a few cool things to talk about today in terms of the announcements. But I thought I'd start by talking about my boy, Caden. Give us a wave, Caden. There he is. He made one of these at school. It's the parable of the sower. And as you turn it around, of course, it shows you the different parts of the parable of the sower. So I thought this morning, let's have the announcements a la Caden. So first thing up is the men's half-day conference on the 27th of August. It's free, but you do have to register. So gentlemen, if you want to go along on the 27th of August to the men's half-day conference with Alan Meyer, I think is the speaker, feel free to pop along to that. But you'll need to register. Speaking of camps and things to attend, there's the Impact Plus Camp. That's the band one. You can see it up there. And it's for woodwind, percussion, brass, age 12 to 30. So feel free to pop along to that to improve your skills and to meet other people who play instruments. Ah, 22 days of prayer. So the Salvos are running. You're invited to join in 22 days of prayer. The focus is Jesus-centred. And it's from August 21, so add 22 to that and you'll get when it finishes. There's different things you can get with that too. There's things for families, for sitting around the table and, you know, talking about the issue, like the particular topic of the day. There's also a personal devotion. There's some online prayer groups that happen each day as well. And I think there's also some theme-based things as well around that. I can't remember exactly. It's in Camberwell Connections. Planned giving. If your planned giving envelopes, if you give in the envelopes, they're all sitting on the table just out there on the way in. If you direct debit, then feel free to keep that direct debit stuff going as well. But if you are planned giving, then make sure you grab your new batch of envelopes. And finally, the intergenerational connect groups. So that's, remember when Meg got up and she spoke about that with Glennis and a few other, and Janet and Chrissy, where are you? Yeah, Chrissy, I saw her this morning. There you are at the back. So I've put my name down. Guys, feel free to become a part of one of those groups. You'll see that there's also a sign-up sheet out there, or you can go and talk to Meg or myself or pretty much anyone. They'll be able to direct you in the right direction. So if you want to become a part of the intergenerational connect groups, it's online. It's only 4 or 5 sessions, and you really can't go wrong. Great chance to connect with other people. Great chance to connect with other people and learn from one another, as I've just learned from Caden. So hope we have a fantastic service this morning. It's awesome to have Kate back. So ladies and gentlemen, here's Kate.
Oh, it's been a while. I think the last time that I was standing in front of you was Easter Sunday morning. And on that occasion, I knew what was going on, but none of you knew. But I'm just so grateful to be standing in front of you again this morning. I was trying to think on the way in and wondering how this moment would feel. And it feels good. It feels really, really good. I have a few thank yous I want to give this morning. Big thank you to Darren. I'm just so grateful, Darren, to be able to go and take the time that I needed and know that you were here. That was just the greatest gift to me. And I'm grateful to Brenda as well, who stepped in just when we needed her. I'm grateful to everything, that all of the work that's been done to get us to this place. I did nothing. I just arrived today. Amazing. And Yvette and Corey have done a lot of work in that area. People have done things to pack down the building and to move out our social services to Camberwell Baptist. It's been just a mammoth effort. I'm aware there's been a whole lot of work going on while I've been resting. So thank you. Thank you to each and every one of you for the part that you have played in bringing us to this place. I want to thank people as well for just the amazing love and care that has been shown to me. For messages and treats sent by Uber Eats even. All kinds of lovely and thoughtful things, that beautiful quilt and all of those knots and the prayers that represented. I was just blown away. I have to be honest with you, I didn't tune in every week to watch, and the reason for that is I just missed you so much, and to not be able to be with you was painful. It was really painful. So it's good. It's really good to be able to be with you this morning. I'm expecting that this morning is going to do me a lot of good. And I'm hoping that you're expecting that same thing. It'll be good to read the word together and to sing together and to worship our God together. Shall we get on with it? Let's do that. I've got this call to worship. It's a responsive reading, and your part will be in italics. Then I looked, and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice,
"Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing."
And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying,
"To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever."
And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshipped. Can I invite you to stand as we worship together? Hosanna. Hosanna to the Lamb that was slain.
Thank you.
need the Lord's comfort in this place at the moment. Amen. I love that scripture, just that picture of the creatures, the living beings in that heavenly place, just giving worship and praise to our God. And I had that on my mind this week and just thinking, you know, what will that look like? And will I be able to fit in to that? And I had an experience of it this week. I was sitting watching TV and I was witness to tens of thousands of people joining in together, lifting their voices in adoration with this melody. Does anyone know that song? Collingwood, Collingwood. And for me, that was not the realms of glory. But it was a reminder to me that we know how to worship. We know how to bring our praise, our adoration. And if we can do that in a place like that, to these athletes, these football teams that, although they are doing some mighty things, they do not know me, they do not love me, they have no knowledge of my existence, yet a God who has created the heavens and the earth, who is without blame, without sin, without flaw, he is holy, he is worthy of that adoration. And I just thought, what a wonderful knowledge that even greater than this thing that we know already how to do when we are in his presence, we are told that we will be in amongst the heavenly beings, all creatures in heaven, on earth, under earth. And I was talking with Jess about this and she said, you know, we're not waiting for that time. We get to be part of that here and now. And when we sing these songs, we're not singing about God, we're singing to God. And so I just encourage us this morning to put ourselves in that position as we sing, holy, you are holy, holy, holy. You are worthy, worthy, worthy. We're going to sing this morning some songs. Just picture yourself in that throne room. You may want to remain standing. At some point, you might want to have a seat and just sit and give God the glory he deserves as we sing together. Not sing Collingwood. Just we'll sing the words on the screen.
Thank you. Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name.
Thank you.
place to lift up a voice or two or three in declaration and affirmation of who he is, of what he's done. I'll leave that space open. We imagine ourselves in your presence. May we experience ourselves in your presence as we declare you to be holy, 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 merciful, mighty, worthy and wonderful. Bless our time here together as we draw our eyes upon you. Take our eyes off ourselves and just declare you as the one who is worthy of all our praise. Amen. Take your seats. We're going to collect the offering now. And as we do so, I think the kids are going to head out for an awesome time at Explorers, no doubt. And thanks to all the great leaders who make that happen. It's fantastic for our kids to have wonderful leaders who love them and care for them.
Sing forever, praise.
sing forever with a thousand hallelujahs. We magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more.
Lord, we pray your blessing upon that which has been collected today. May it be used for your glory, for your purpose. Amen.
Having Jesus in your life makes a difference, doesn't it? And as you can imagine, I've been thinking a lot about the difference that Jesus makes in your life. As I look out over all of the faces here, I see people who have gone through a lot of tough stuff, a lot of difficult things. But what we share and what we know is that Jesus loves us, doesn't he? And he holds us. I had a beautiful message come through from someone in the congregation, just these few lines. It said, "And underneath are the everlasting arms." That is something that I have experienced during this time, and I'm sure for many people here, you could testify to that as well, that he holds us, doesn't he? We're going to sing a song now that it's a song of testimony. It's a song about the difference that Jesus makes in our life. It reminds us, those of us who are Christ followers, just what has changed for us since Jesus came into our life. This one thing I know, God in great mercy pardoned me, snapped sin's fetters and set me free. Once I was blind, but now I see. This one thing I know. Let's sing together.
Thank you.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from Mark chapter 10, verses 46 to 52. Then they reached Jericho, and as Jesus and his disciples left town, a large crowd followed him. A blind beggar named Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, was sitting beside the road. When Bartimaeus heard that Jesus of Nazareth was nearby, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." "Be quiet," many of the people yelled at him. But he only shouted louder, "Son of David, have mercy on me." When Jesus heard him, he stopped and said, "Tell him to come here." So they called the blind man. "Cheer up," they said. "Come on, he's calling you." Bartimaeus threw aside his coat, jumped up, and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked. "My rabbi," the blind man said, "I want to see." And Jesus said to him, "Go, for your faith has healed you." Instantly the man could see, and he followed Jesus down the road. Amen. Well, it's my very great pleasure this morning to introduce you to Reverend Dr. Arseny Ermakov. Arseny is a senior lecturer here at Eva Burrows College, where he's been serving, ministering here since 2011. He's also taught at European Nazarene College and Nazarene Theological College in the United Kingdom, and served as a pastor at St. Petersburg Church of the Nazarene in Russia. He's an author as well. And in collaboration with Andrew Brower Latz, Arseny has published an edited volume called Purity, Essays in Bible and Theology, and recently has finished working on the Gospel of Matthew, a commentary in Wesleyan tradition, in cooperation with Robert Snow. Arseny, we are blessed to have you come and be with us this morning. We're delighted that you'll be bringing the word to us, and I'd like to invite you to come up and I will pray for you. Lord God, once again, we come before you and we are grateful to be in this place. We're grateful that when we come before you, inevitably you speak to us. And so as your word is opened today, as Arseny brings your truth, I pray that you would be, first of all, with him, that you would give him peace, that you would give him confidence in the word that you have given to him. And Lord Jesus, that you would give us eyes to see and ears to hear the word that you have for us today. We don't want to go from this place empty-handed. We want to take everything that you have for us. And so just in these moments, I pray that you would quieten our spirit, that we would be ready and willing to receive from you. We pray in your precious name. Amen. Amen. Welcome, Arseny.
Thank you. Do you still not perceive or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you still have ears and fail to hear? Do you have eyes and fail to see? Jesus poses these confronting questions not to his opponents, notorious scribes and Pharisees, but to his disciples. It's a shocking discovery for a careful reader of the Gospel of Mark that the 12 apostles, closest followers and leaders of the church, are in fact blind. Jesus, and disappointed and frustrated that they failed to see and fully grasp his full identity, his destiny, and the magnitude of their shared ministry to the people of God. Mark illustrates these disciples' struggle to comprehend by the story of the healing of a blind man in chapter 8. In that incident, Jesus heals a man in two stages. At first, Jesus puts his saliva and lays his hands on the blind eyes. The man can see only partially. "I see people who look like walking trees," he says. Then Jesus lays his hands for the second time, and then, only then, the sight is restored. This episode is then followed by Peter's confession of who Jesus truly is. Peter says, "You are the Messiah, we know." But soon as the Anointed One mentions that he has to suffer and die, Peter rebukes him. And Jesus gets really annoyed again and spares no words for the leading apostle. "Get behind me, Satan." The 12 can see clearly for a moment and then fail miserably right away. Insight and misunderstanding often travel together on the path of discipleship. Later in the Markan story in chapter 10, Jesus meets another blind man as he makes his way through the streets of Jericho. This story that we read this morning is significant for Mark as it signals a change in the narrative. Jesus finished his ministry and proclamation of the good news in Galilee, and now, as a part of the pilgrim crowd from the north, travels to Jerusalem to celebrate the greatest festival of the Jewish calendar, Passover. But Jesus also knows that Jerusalem is the final stop of his earthly journey. The Messiah must suffer and give his life as ransom for many. This is a stumbling block for the 12 who still believe in the triumphal and conquering Messiah and are blind to the idea of a suffering one. At this point in the story, Jesus meets a blind beggar who is named for some reason. Perhaps because he was known in the early Christian community to the first readers of the Markan Gospel. His name is Bartimaeus, means the son of Timaeus or the son of honor. But look at him. In the ancient world, his disability was viewed as shameful. Religious people of the day would see Bartimaeus as unclean. Because of his blindness, he cannot follow purity rules from the Torah. And some regulations, temple regulations, tell us that you keep those kind of people away from the temple. He is unclean. He is not worthy to worship together with us. Disability leads him to poverty. He can't work. He begs. Why isn't his family taking care of him? Isn't he a burden? An outcast? The son of Timaeus finds himself on the fringes of ancient society and on the streets of Jericho. Where is your honor, Bartimaeus? Where is your honor, the son of honor? But then something remarkable happens. He hears that Jesus of Nazareth passes by, surrounded by pilgrim crowds. Bartimaeus loves this time of the year. And not because of the festive spirit in the air, but because Passover pilgrims are encouraged by the rabbis to give generously to the poor. Cha-ching! But this time, it's not about money. Something within him, to his own surprise, wanted to cry in utter desperation, "Son of David, have mercy on me!" Without complete realization, this blind beggar perceives Jesus' true identity and publicly confesses it. This Galilean rabbi from Nazareth is more than he appears to be. He is the Messiah, anointed one, the king from the house of David. And this remarkable confession anticipates Jesus' triumphal entry to Jerusalem, his royal visitation to the holy city. And that happens just in the next episode. But this also a dangerous thing to say out loud, Bartimaeus. Shut up! Roman soldiers might be nearby. Passover festivities always make occupying Roman forces nervous, because Jews gather to celebrate freedom from the Egyptian bondage and might riot again in an attempt to get rid of the pagan overlords. Bartimaeus' words could be easily interpreted as a call to gather around the rightful heir to David's throne and rebel. Shut up, Bartimaeus! Shut up! You will get us into trouble. But Bartimaeus is persistent in his confession. Son of David, have mercy on me! Here we encounter Mark's cheeky side. He is the master of irony. The blind beggar sees something that the 12 apostles have failed to perceive. And disgraced son of honor meets his royal highness. One thing for sure. Bartimaeus knew how to attract public attention, and Jesus noticed him. And here we are faced with another interesting language. Three times the word calling appears. Mark uses the same word to describe the calling of the first disciples and later the 12 apostles. And now Jesus calls Bartimaeus. And Mark noticed the little detail in his response. He abandons his cloak and goes. Like the first disciples, he leaves everything he has, his only possession, not to ever return back to the old life of a disgraced beggar. Encounter with Jesus changes his life forever. The son of David asked Bartimaeus a penetrating question. What do you want me to do for you? And this question appears four times in the gospel and is designed to reveal a person's deep desires and quality of character. It also just popped in the story before the healing in Jericho. James and John, the close apostles, leading apostles, came to Jesus to ask for a favor. And Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" And they wanted power. They wanted status. They wanted recognition. They wanted to become nobility in the kingdom of heaven, to sit at the right and the left in the glory of the King. Mark juxtaposes their ambition and thirst for power to Bartimaeus' request. I just want to see. Again. Some other biblical manuscripts have the blind beggar say, I just want to see you. I just want to see Jesus. I don't want power. I don't want status. I don't have an ambition to climb up the ladder. In this simple response, he recognizes his powerlessness. When the apostles look for power, he confesses his weakness while the apostles pursue status. He wants to see while the apostles are blinded by culturally driven rat race to the top. If Jesus asked you today, what do you want me to do for you? What will be your response? This simple desire to see was met with gracious response from the Son of David. Your faith had made you well. But also, you can translate that phrase that your faith has saved you. Mark uses this word there called sozo, Greek word, that is translated as save. And it's a very potent word in the New Testament. And in this point, restoration of health and sight and salvation actually synonymous. This reveals the holistic notion of salvation. It embraces the whole of person. It's not only about restoration of relationship with God, but physical recovery. It also talks about social restoration. Now he can work again. He can return to his family. It also talks about religious restoration. He now returned to the temple worship. And his human dignity was restored. The son of honor does not have to live in shame anymore. He perceived the identity of Jesus while he was blind, and now he can see his Savior with his own eyes and receive a new identity. And what was his response to that? Did he want to return to the ordinary life? Bartimaeus' response to God's act of healing and salvation was to follow Jesus. Not just to go to Jerusalem with him, but to become his follower and join him on the mission of God. At the beginning of the story, remember, Bartimaeus was sitting on the side of the road, a sign of exclusion. And now he is part of the community, following Jesus on the way, on the path of discipleship. We traditionally interpret this story as a healing event. But Mark focuses on something else here. He does not even provide us a description of healing. To receive sight turns into a metaphor for discipleship. The story is much bigger. It brings together revelation of Jesus' true identity, healing, salvation, calling, self-denial, unconditional following, and the meaning of discipleship. For Mark, Bartimaeus represents an ideal follower of Christ who perceives Jesus' identity, receives the salvific grace of God, and responds with faith to the call to follow. Another Markan irony is at play here. This minor, secondary, non-important character of the gospel shows the true example of follower to the leading apostles. So, what can we learn from this small story? Often in our and my beloved evangelical tradition, we seek easy answers to complicated questions. How do I receive healing? Well, follow four easy steps of Bartimaeus. Confess, clearly say what you want, believe, and receive. 1, 2, 3, 4, and salvation and healing is in my pocket, my friend. The Gospel of Mark, how do I say that politely? The Gospel of Mark doesn't invite this kind of interpretation and resist any attempts to trivialize the gospel of Jesus Christ and turn the good news into banality of easy solutions. Every encounter with Jesus in the gospel is different and sparked a variety of faith responses to the acts of God's salvation. If you will, Mark is full of examples of different faith pathways. See, here I'm using salvationist lingo here. And one just can't bring everything to lowest common denominator. However, there is something that you and I could grasp and hold tightly to. Bartimaeus' faith pathway, though unique, threads across the landscape of shared Christian experience and highlights once again the importance of faith. Faith that welcomes the transformative presence of God in our lives. Such a faith responds to divine grace that radically reorients our life's direction. Faith that allows receiving a new sight, a new perspective on life. Faith that leads us to confess our powerlessness and realize complete dependence on God. Faith that gets hold of Christ and does not let him go. Such a faith, stubborn, persevering, courageous, yet deeply perceiving faith that drives us from our comfort zones and leads us into denying ourselves, makes us to leave everything behind and follow Jesus. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Have some time now to respond to that message. Thank you, Dr. Arseny, for a God, that Jesus, who sees us and asks us, what can I do for you? We're going to sing some songs, a couple of tunes that you'll know will be familiar to you. Open my eyes, Lord. I want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch him and say that I love him.
Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch him. To listen.
thank you that even when we cannot see what is inside us, that you can see. You at least have eyes to see. Lord God, give us the courage to ask ourselves this question: what do we really want? What do we want? Help us to answer it honestly. And if there's things there that need to be dealt with, if the things that we want are not what you would have for us, then Lord God, give us eyes to see that. Lord God, my prayer is that when you ask us, what do you want me to do for you? That like Bartimaeus, our cry would be, Lord Jesus, I want to see you. I want to see you. I want to see you at work in my life. I want to see you at work in the world. I don't want a storybook image of you, but I want to know the truth. I want to know who you really are, Son of David, and what you're calling me to. Lord Jesus, that's the cry of our heart, that you would lead us into true discipleship. That like Bartimaeus, when our eyes are open, that we would leave our coat behind and we would follow you into truth. Lord, give us eyes to see. We pray in your precious name. Amen. The final song together. I invite you to stand. Oh, this is a good one. We can clap to this one. Let's stand together. He came to give us life in all its fullness. He came to make the blind to see. He came to banish death and doubt and darkness. He came to set his people free. Amen. Let's sing.
Thank you.
A benediction. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honour and glory and blessing. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honour and glory and might forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Thank you.